49 in the purple Sing the Storybook. And for those of you who have just come, this gathering period is an opportunity for you to shout out the numbers you would like to sing. Number 49 in Sing the Story. We have time for one more.
305.
Pardon me?
305.
Number 305 in the Blue Hymnal of Worship book. 305. And Diane, I think we might have needed a little support for this one.
Thank you.
And now Lee and Susan Dengler will lead us in our prelude.
The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims God's handiwork. Welcome to worship at College Mennonite Church on June 17th, Father's Day for many of us, especially welcome to those of you who are fathers and grandfathers and men who've had a fathering, nurturing relationship with others. Welcome to those of you here in this space and to those of you who are not here, who are with us through some form of electronic media. We are glad that you are with us. I invite you to take your bulletins and turn to the call to worship, and we will read responsively. A mighty wind has blown, and tongues of fire have danced. Glory to God. Gloria a Dios. The Spirit is with us, just as Jesus promised. Glory to God. Gloria a Dios. God's Spirit is poured out upon us. Worship God with joy. Glory to God. Gloria a Dios. I invite you to take your Sing the Journey books, the green books, and turn to number 16, and to stand as we sing Praise with Joy, the World's Creator.
Thank you.
Our next song is number 55 in the Blue Hymnal of Worship book. Cantemos al Señor. Let us sing unto the Lord. Feel free to sing in English or in Spanish. Response that we will sing during the prayers of the people is number 104 in the purple Sing the Storybook. We will sing through this prayer, this refrain once, and then Phil will lead us in prayer.
Please join me in prayer. For the Church of God in all places, that it be filled with truth and love, and found without fault at the day of your coming, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, including those serving on behalf of this congregation, and for our sister congregations in New Orleans and Fort Myers, and for the church in Africa, particularly in Tanzania. We pray to you, O Lord. For the peace of the world, let a spirit of respect and forbearance grow among nations and peoples, that those in positions of public trust serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. For the reduction of violence in our schools and other public places, for the well-being of immigrants and refugees, and for our own country, we pray to you, O Lord.
Amen.
for all who live and work in this community, for a blessing on all human labor, that your gifts of creation are used to free the world from poverty, famine, and disaster. For the work of fathers and of all men who seek to do your will, we pray to you, O Lord. For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who grieve and suffer. For refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger. For Robina Summers and her family at the death of her mother. For Jan Gleistein and the family of his wife, Barbara. For Karen, Dwayne, Emily, and Kate, and the family of Lon Shear. For Che Hines, for Mr. Van Verst, we pray to you, O Lord. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, and with gratitude for your steadfast love and mercy, we commit ourselves and all our life to Christ. Grant that all who have been reborn in the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in our lives what we profess by faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit. Amen. This time, I'd like to invite the children, the young children, to come forward for the children's time and invite us to turn in our hymnals as we sing them forward to number 293. That's the blue hymnals, God Sends Us the Spirit.
And every time we sing the phrase, Spirit Friend, I invite you to clap that out, Spirit Friend. It'll come up numerous times, and that will add some energy to our singing.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I look a little different to you, hopefully, this morning. What are some things that I have on that look a little funny here at church?
Glasses.
I usually don't wear glasses because I have contacts. So those of you that know me well enough, I usually don't wear glasses. And this coat, this is my robe. So I was putting this on in the back of church, and one of my boys goes, "It's morning, Mommy." This is morning, Mommy. I'm in my robe, I'm in my glasses. This is what I look like at home when I'm in morning Mommy mode. What else would I usually not wear to church? What do you think? A Phillies t-shirt. Usually when I go to church, I dress nicely, I wear some of my best clothes. I don't wear a Phillies t-shirt. But this Phillies t-shirt, you would know I wear because I am the wife of an avid Phillies fan. And so when I got married, I had to become a Phillies fan. So I have a couple shirts, and I have to wear them during Phillies games and when we go to the games. So this is kind of one I want to wear, and maybe I'd even wear it for Father's Day because, you know, he's a Phillies fan. So I wear this because I'm a wife. What's something else that you see that I wouldn't wear to church? Miles? Yeah, sometimes I don't wear it. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. What else, Seth? Yeah, somebody said this is a funny necklace. And this is called a lanyard. And I have to wear this when I go to school because this has a picture of it on me and this gets me into my building. And so when I'm a teacher, I'm always wearing this. So when I wear these things at different places, sometimes I look a little funny. But some of you know me as a mom, some of you may know me as a teacher, some of you know me as a wife or a friend. You guys would expect me to see me in a dress or kind of fancy sometimes because I come to church that way. That's how I dress when I come to church. So even though I'm one person, I have a lot of different jobs. And that's one thing that we're going to talk about, and I want you to listen for today, is we're going to talk about how sometimes God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit are one person. And sometimes that's a little confusing to think about. So what I want you to do is think about, can you picture in your head a picture of God? If you were to close your eyes, could you have a picture of God in your head? Give me a thumbs up if you can make a picture of God in your head. Okay, now, what about if I said have a picture of Jesus? Could you have a picture of Jesus in your head? Give me a thumbs up if you can have a picture of Jesus in your head. Some people are pretty quick at this. Now, what if I said have a picture of the Holy Spirit in your head? Ooh, the thumbs are not coming up so quickly. Sometimes the Holy Spirit is something a little tricky for us to understand. And when I think of the Holy Spirit, I think of the Holy Spirit as a feeling that moves me to do good things. And we'll talk about the fruits of the Holy Spirit, and you might want to think about those if you know some of those. But the Holy Spirit is kind of this feeling that we have to get us to do good things. So we have this picture at home, and I had to kind of, this picture book, I had to bring it in to show you, because this is where Morning Mommy comes in, and it's just kind of funny. The beginning of it, it says, "My mom is great. She is so good at everything. I think my mom's magic. Every morning, her magic begins when she disappears into the bathroom, and she changes from Morning Mommy into Daytime Mommy." So that's kind of what I did before your eyes today. And then it goes on to list a whole list of things that this mom is good at. My mom is not afraid of anything, that she can rescue the cat. My mom never lets me down and always finds the toys that I'm missing. And And then my mom can fix almost anything and fixes the stuffed doll, so it's just as good as new. Oh, and my mom is a fantastic cook. All of these wonderful things that this mom can do. And of course, his mom can make him smile and give him hugs. It's probably what moms are best at, right? And then it says at the end, toward the end of the day, my mom's magic starts to fade. But by the time I'm ready for bed, she has changed back into morning mommy. But I don't care what my mom looks like. I don't even care if she's not really magic, because whatever she does, she is my mom, and my mom is great. So what I want you to think about today is, how could you be great? Maybe it'd feel like you're doing a little bit of magic. Maybe it would feel like you're just doing kind things for others. You can think about some of the things in this book. But then you can also think about the fruits of the Spirit that are important. So doing things that are kind, showing love, being patient, maybe showing a little self-control, those things that are really important for us to do. Now, I tried to come up with a fun way to think about this. So what I did for you today is, just like I had on all of my different clothes, I came up with a mask, and I'm gonna give each of you a mask. And you can color it, decorate it, do whatever you want during the rest of the service or at home. And then when you go home today, you can choose. You can have somebody at home help you put this on with just some string around your head. And maybe you can go around and do great things, the fruits of the Spirit, and do kind things and loving things for others. Or if you just want to put this up somewhere at your house as a reminder to do the things that the Holy Spirit would want us to do, and think about that this week. Okay? So let's pray, and then we'll come up and get these. Dear God, thank you for our time together today. Please be with us this week. And let the Holy Spirit fill us and help us to do great things. In your name, amen. All right, you can go ahead and get your worship bags and come up and get a mask.
And we will sing to prepare ourselves to hear the scripture text and the sermon by singing together number 25 in the Green Sing the Journey book, When Long Before Time. For this song to work well, we have to have a feeling of dancing like a waltz together. So if you're able to sing one of the four parts and still feel the waltz, feel free to sing a part. But if you would do better by following the waltz by singing the melody, feel free to do that too.
Thank you.
Our preacher this morning is Talasha Chaim Yoder, one of our pastors here at College Mennonite Church. I invite you to join me with prayer for Talasha and for us during this sermon. Gracious God, we give you thanks for Talasha, for her gifts that you have called forth in service to the church. Thank you for the time she has spent praying and studying, for these minutes ahead of us. Bless us, we pray, through her. Speak to us, move us, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Well, I am going to start this morning by introducing you to some things that are very important in our house. This is Buddy. Buddy is very important, and so is George. George and Buddy were Malachi's attachment items when he was a toddler. Some of you who worked in the toddler room may recognize Buddy and George. And this, let's see here, who else do we have? Oh, it escaped. This is Zeph's cow lovey. You can see it's a cow head on a blanket. I don't know why a blanket with a head is so comforting for young children, but it seems to be. And this is his blanket that was also very important. This was mine when I was a baby and is Zeph's favorite blanket. Now, these have all been very important in our house, and they've been very important for us as we go out into the world. Buddy and George and the cow lovey and the blanket have made it possible for Daniel and me to be apart from our children sometimes. That's especially important here at church, where sometimes on Sunday mornings, we can't be with them the whole time. These items came with them to the toddler room or to Sunday school, and I remember Malachi looking at Buddy and imagining Buddy saying to him, "Mommy and Daddy, come back." These attachment items, they made life possible for us. And really, they're still kind of important. So I did promise the boys that when I was done talking about them, I would give them back. So here you go, guys. Okay. Now, none of us are kidded into thinking that Buddy and George and a cow lovey and a blanket are adequate substitutes for Mommy and Daddy. We know that they are really a consolation prize, right? They're not the real thing. I think Sam Miller can probably remember holding Zeph on his lap and reading him book after book after book to help him cope with the separation from Daniel and me during Sunday school. They were very important and very helpful, but they are second rate. Right? They're not the real thing. Well, as I prepared for this sermon, thought about our relationship with the Holy Spirit, it occurred to me that we sometimes think of the Holy Spirit as a blankie. We hear the story of Jesus telling the disciples in many more words than this, "I'm leaving you, but I'll still be with you," well, kind of, "but I'm sending you my advocate." When read alone, Holy Spirit is a blankie. We have historically had an unformed theology of the Holy Spirit. When we start talking about the work of the Holy Spirit, many of us begin to kind of shift around in our seats. The Holy Spirit is probably one of the most misunderstood, misused, distrusted parts of theology in the Western world. Now, I am aware that many in this sanctuary have deep and rich understandings of the Holy Spirit. So know that this morning I'm not trying to discount that very good work you have done. But generally speaking, we have relegated the Holy Spirit to a blankie status, the consolation prize that Jesus sends when he's not going to be with us in the flesh. How did we get here? There's a lot going on here, and I think the deeper we dig, the more complex it becomes. A few weeks ago, I asked Growing Roots, the Sunday school class made up mostly of young families, how many of them remembered celebrating Pentecost as children? There were five of us who raised our hands, me and the four members of our group who are from Indonesia, which is very interesting. Then I asked how many felt that they had a strong understanding of the Holy Spirit. Very few responded in the affirmative. General consensus was that the Holy Spirit is confusing and isn't an aspect of God that our parents or our churches really spent a lot of time on. Many also associated the Holy Spirit with the charismatic movement, which during our childhood was on its decline, and there was a lot of skepticism directed toward the charismatic movement in the time that we would remember. Throughout history, the Holy Spirit has made us squirmy. Our rejection of this thing that we don't understand has done a disservice to the growth of the church and to the development of our faith. I would argue that it has done particular violence to women. The Holy Spirit is assigned these feminine aspects of God, and that has threatened the patriarchal structure for centuries. When the Holy Spirit, when she is relegated to the basement of our faith, then our understanding of the role of women and girls in the church also becomes warped and incomplete. And perhaps the biggest obstacle that we have faced in grasping the Holy Spirit is that we often only view the Holy Spirit through New Testament eyes. We sometimes talk about people having an Old Testament understanding of God. Well, sometimes we have a New Testament understanding of the Holy Spirit. Yes, the Holy Spirit was uniquely revealed at Pentecost, but she has been alive and well since before the beginning of time. Genesis 1, 1 through 5, the very beginning of our Bible. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. A wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Ruach, Ruach Elohim, the breath, the wind, the spirit of God. I love this imagery. In this chaos, this formlessness, the Holy Spirit hovers, ready for action. The world is tohu wabohu, another fun Hebrew phrase to say, which means it was without function. It had no purpose. It had no meaning. There is something that is lacking, something that should be here. The passage doesn't say, in the beginning there was nothing and then God created. It says that there was watery chaos and the Spirit of God, Ruach Elohim, was already there. One of the first Hebrew words I learned was Ruach. It's a big, encompassing word, and it's usually translated as either wind or spirit, but really it's big enough to mean both. The Ruach Elohim, the Spirit of God, is often described as an instrument of God in the Hebrew Bible. It's the aspect of God that makes things happen, God in action. In the Exodus story, it is Ruach Elohim that separates the waters so the people can walk through. When Ruach Elohim is hovering over the waters in these first two verses of the Bible, this is a sign that God's potential is about to be realized. The Holy Spirit is here before the dawn of time. And then what happens? Ruach Elohim disrupts the power of chaos. Creation in the ancient Near East was not about making something from nothing. It was an organizing, a reordering of that which already existed. Ruach Elohim takes tohu wa bohu, this meaningless, functionless chaos, and reorders it, gives it purpose. First is separating the light from the darkness. Have you ever thought about or noticed in this passage that rest, the evening, comes before the morning? The rest comes before the work of the day. In God's mercy, rest comes before the work of the day. Think about that. The Holy Spirit breathes into the world a rhythm for life. Just rest in the promise of that for a moment. I'm going to have a little confession time here. I began as your pastor 9.5 years ago. And at that point, my understanding of the Holy Spirit was very cerebral. This was not due to lack of study. It was not negligence on the part of my Bible professors. And really, I could articulate a fairly solid theology of the Trinity. But the Holy Spirit is something that we can't just know about up here. Really, the Holy Spirit is something we need to grasp with our whole being. It is a holistic thing to understand. And I really didn't get it. And about the time that I started pastoring here, I was asked to portray the Holy Spirit through dance at a Mennonite youth convention in Columbus. So I was supposed to, without words, dance this aspect of God that I was still struggling to understand. Now, I always feel most connected with God when dancing. And so my preparation for portraying the Holy Spirit was a really rich experience for me. It was a time of a lot of connection with God. The first worship service of convention was focused on the creation. And I led some of my students, in doing a stomp-style dance portraying the creation story. Do we have a picture of that? I'm hoping. We may. If a picture pops up later, you'll know what it is. So I was Ruach Elohim in this, portraying the Holy Spirit at work in creation. In preparing for that, I felt my Holy Spirit block starting to crack a little bit. And then came the second worship time, and this was the one that I was nervous about. I was supposed to dance while Ken Miedema sang a response song after the speaker spoke. Now, if you know who Ken Miedema is, he is known for his improvisational style. And he is known for making songs up on the spot. If you know me, you know that I like to be prepared and that I always feel I'm at my most flexible and improvisational when I have a lot of preparation time. Thank you. That is the creation dance. So this was a little bit nerve-wracking for me. Ken was going to be making up a song, and I was going to be dancing to it, and this was going to be a song that did not yet exist. So I did not know the tempo, the lyrics, the tune, the meter, the length, the time signature, nothing. Also, Ken is blind, and so I was not going to be able to communicate with him through eye contact. Also, this was a Mennonite youth convention, which meant that images from the worship service, including myself, would be projected onto jumbotrons throughout the space. There was nowhere to hide. I was feeling very vulnerable. I knew that this was not something that my careful preparation could really see me through. I remember standing by the stage and taking a really big, deep breath in and out and saying, okay, I don't have this, and praying that God would fill in all the spaces, would make order out of this chaos. Well, Ken was a little long-winded that night. The song was 20 minutes long. And during those 20 minutes, I finally got the Holy Spirit. The spaces between Ken and me were filled with Ruach Elohim, the breath of God hovering over and breathing order into what felt like chaos. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we crescendoed and decrescendoed together. We paused simultaneously. We responded to the 5,000 youth who were gathered in that space together. And my tired and newly pregnant body lasted until I made it off the stage. I would not say that the Holy Spirit worked in my heart that night. No, I would say that the power of the Holy Spirit worked communally. And through that communal worship experience, through Ruach Elohim breathing through all of it, I caught the Spirit. I began to understand that what I had been calling communion with God or nudges of God were uniquely this aspect of God, this Holy Spirit part of God. Maybe I had been overthinking this, getting a little too cerebral. Maybe I needed to get out of my head. The Holy Spirit is. Ruach Elohim is big and all-encompassing. The breath of God is flexible and mobile and can move through the cracks in our armor, can grow and fill the spaces between us and within us. The Holy Spirit is not a blankie, is not this consolation prize given to us by Jesus. The Holy Spirit is God revealed in this time, in this place. Ruach Elohim has been working to give this world what it needs since before the dawn of time, since her first gift of dusk and dawn. The Spirit of God hovers over our chaos, ready to breathe order into it. Right now, we are experiencing tragic human-made chaos in our world. The stories and pictures that we are seeing from our nation's southern borders are horrific. Today it's Father's Day. And it is impossible to not think of the children who just want their daddies and of the fathers who have been separated from their children, all for the crime of wanting to not feel hopeless and to try to get out of danger. The chaos of families torn apart directly violates the gospel of Jesus, the call to love and to care. The situation on our southern border is not of God. And yet, Ruach Elohim hovers over this chaos. We see glimpses of this in the way that Christians are rising up in protest, that people from all over the political spectrum are standing up and saying, this is not right. The Holy Spirit hovers over this tohu wabohu, this formless thing that has no purpose. In this time, in this place, we are called to let the Spirit catch us and stir us to work to disrupt the power of chaos in this world. In the chaos of the world, the Holy Spirit hovers. In the chaos of this nation, the Holy Spirit hovers. In the chaos of our community, the Holy Spirit hovers. In the chaos of this church, the Holy Spirit hovers. In the chaos of our work lives, our relationships, our families, the Holy Spirit hovers. Ruach Elohim may not make the order that we anticipate, but when we set the Holy Spirit free, she will breathe order into our watery deep. Amen.
New Earth, Heavens New. This is our song of testimony to the power of the Spirit, and I invite you to stand if you're able as we sing this song.
We will not have sharing by community life today. That has been postponed to a different date after a very hectic week. Instead, we will proceed now on to our time of offering. In gratitude for God's provision and daily presence with us, we now give back. Bring your offerings forward or send them up with a child, and also please sign and pass the friendship books that are located at the ends of your aisles. And if there's someone in your pew, that you don't know, then check their name in there so you can say hello after.
Thank you.
Let's pray. God, you have been present since before time began. Your work is more intricate and more expansive than we can imagine. We offer these gifts to you in confidence that you are at work in using them to further your kingdom. May our whole lives be lived in communion with your Holy Spirit, with each other, and with your good creation. Amen.
Our closing blessing is number 77 in the green Sing the Journey book. The peace of the earth be with you.
For our sending, I invite you to turn in the blue hymnal to number 762. This is a responsive reading. Come, Holy Spirit. Send us, abide with us, use us, that the Father may be glorified, and our joy may be made full. Amen. Go in peace.